Hello, upholstery friends. I'm joined here today by Rebecca Munster. Hello, Rebecca.
Hi.
Rebecca has a business called Rebecca Munster Designs, and she's located in Poolsville, Maryland. And I've asked Rebecca here today to share her journey into the upholstery world with you, because if you're like me, you really find it interesting to see how other people get going. And sometimes we get ideas, or sometimes we have aha moments and say, that's exactly what happened to me. So Rebecca, would you like to share a little bit about yourself with our viewers?
Yeah, absolutely. So I spent the first 20 years of my career in IT, working as a project manager and building a big software development team. I always, though, was interested in being creative, and I knew how to sew, and I do a lot of stuff on the sides, you know, drapery and upholstery and things like that, but hadn't made it a career yet. And after I had my last baby, I gave up my career in IT and knew I was going to reinvent myself. And it really sort of happened organically. My friends were like, oh, now that you're home, can you make something for me? You know, I really wanted some new drapes, or I have cushions I need, or a chair I need upholstered. And it really happened very, very organically from there. So it's been about 5 years that I've been doing it full time and really loving it.
That sounds very similar to a lot of stories I hear. It's like once your friends find out you've got that talent and skill, it's like, hey, I've got work for you.
Exactly.
So when did you realize it was a business and actually turn it into something that you made money at?
Yeah, it was probably about 2 years into it that I said, okay, now I've got to, this is just happening and it's growing and I need to really make this a business and put the processes and logo and, you know, all the good stuff that needed to go along with it so that it could be a reputable business.
Now, are you retail to clients or do you work with designers or both?
Mostly retail. Every once in a while, I'll work with a designer here and there, but it's mostly retail that I do.
So if a client wants to work with you, can you explain a little bit how your process works? Do you, you know, do you go to them? Do they come to you?
Yeah. So I think lately I've been getting a lot of email requests or through Facebook messages with pictures and things. When possible, I really do like to go out and visit with the client and, you know, see their home to help them pick out fabrics and make sure that what they're picking is going to look right in their home. Mm-hmm. And they like to be able to look at the fabrics in their home too. So we'll, you know, schedule a meeting, do a little consultation, give them a quote, and then coordinate getting the furniture over to my house and go from there.
So do you sell the fabrics as well?
Yes. Yes, I do. Okay. Mm-hmm.
So what do you find to be your biggest challenge? Whether it's working with clients or, time. I think we all have that factor, don't we?
Time. I have a 5-year-old and a 10-year-old daughters. And so it's always a challenge balancing being a mom and running a business. And then just wearing all the hats, you know, for so long when I was in the corporate world, I had a whole accounting department to count on and a marketing department, and I've got to do it all. So just finding the time to do it all. My installer for draperies the other day said to me, oh, you do upholstery? I didn't know that. That's a dying trade, which it made me sad that he said it's a dying trade. But I think the point was there's just not a lot of you around. So once people know you do upholstery, it's like the requests just are coming in fast and furious.
So would you say upholstery is the biggest part of your business?
No, it's probably about half and half between window treatments and upholstery. And then a cushion thrown in here, cushions and pillows here and there.
Yeah, I know. I talk to a lot of people who like the window treatment side of their business will slow down, but the upholstery side, I don't know about you, but it seems pretty steady for most people.
It does. I think when I looked at the end of the year, it ended up being pretty even between the two. However, the upholstery is the steady one. Like it's just constantly coming in. So I have peaks and valleys with the window treatment.
So do you prefer to do one over the other or do you like them both equally?
I really don't. I like them both equally. And it's funny because whenever I get done with one project, I think that's the one I like better than I go and do another one. And I'm like, no, wait, maybe I like upholstery better. So I like them both.
I like the fact that with upholstery, you put the fabric on the chair and you get it to the client's house and there's no surprises. But with window treatments, that's not always the case.
That is true. That is true. It is, installation day is definitely nerve-wracking.
Yeah, yeah, you never know what the fabric's going to do when you actually put it on the rod sometimes.
That's true.
So you mentioned social media, that's how people mm-hmm. are finding you. So do you use, which yeah. social media platforms do you use?
Facebook mostly. I'm just going to start dabbling into Instagram, but Facebook's the primary social media that I use right now.
There was actually a conversation, and you may have seen this the other day, that somebody uh-huh. was asking the question in one of the groups, is the phone book worth it? And it's social media for everybody I speak to has become their main means of communication with new clients. Yeah. So it's a whole different world than it was 20 years ago when I started.
Yeah, it is the phone book today, I think.
Do you have employees in your business, Rebecca?
I don't. I do have a couple of folks that'll come in and help me on sort of a contract basis here and there when I'm really busy. I do want to grow in that direction, and I could see the need for having some employees eventually. You know, after working in large teams for so long, I think I was a little burnt out from managing. Mm-hmm. But now that I've 5 years been by myself, I kind of miss having a team. So I hope to have a team again eventually.
If you're like me, your team is you talking to yourself.
Yes, yeah, most of the time. My 5-year-old was downstairs with me in the workroom in my lower level studio the other day. And she goes, Mom, are you in there talking to yourself? Yep, every day.
I've seen a couple pictures of her on Facebook. She is adorable.
Yeah, she's funny.
So what is the favorite part of what you do for you?
Yeah, it's probably, I love that initial consultation and getting the client really excited about transforming their furniture and transforming their homes. That's really fun. But there's also something so satisfying about putting Humpty Dumpty back together again. As you're putting each of those pieces of fabric on that furniture, and you see it transforming from, you know, the ugly duckling to a swan. That's very satisfying. I love that.
I love that Humpty Dumpty comparison. That is so perfect. I had never thought of it in those terms before, and that really fits it to a T.
I always feel like I'm putting Humpty Dumpty back together again.
So you said the future is possible employees for you somewhere mm-hmm. down the road. What about any other expansions for your business or different ways you want to grow, whether it be other services or something?
Yeah. At some point, I think I want to move out of my home. There's pros and cons, right? It's so great. I can be here and see the girls when they get off the bus, and it keeps expenses down and other things. But there's hard things too. You know, I'm trying to focus on my job, and then I think, oh, I really should do a load of laundry. Oh, there's toys all over the living room. Let me pick those up really quickly. Or just it's hard to walk away at the end of the day and have breaks that we all need, even, mm-hmm. even when we love our jobs, we all need to be able to close the door at the end of the day and go home. So at some point I'd like to have a larger space and be outside of my lower level studio.
So are you one of those people that you wake up in the middle of the night and you're like, I didn't finish that today. I'm going to go down.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
That's another curse of being at home.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what does a typical weekday workday look like for you?
Yeah, that's probably one of those things that I wish I could get better at, sort of structuring my week. Having been in project management for so long, I like structure. But I, you know, with clients calling and setting up appointments, sometimes it's not as structured as I'd like it to be. But I try to stack all my client appointments on a couple days a week so that I can have longer periods in the workroom working on projects. So most days, by the time I get the girls out to school in the morning, I'm down in the workroom by about 9, and I try to stay there and just, you know, get straight to the workroom. I don't sit down at my computer and answer emails or anything like that, because then I could get stuck there all day. Go straight down to the workroom and just work on my projects. I like to have 2 or 3 sort of going on at once, because for a couple reasons, sometimes my brain needs break from one to kind of move on to the other. And sometimes my physical body, needs a break from certain tasks. Mm-hmm, yeah. Move on to the other. So I'll work until about 3 o'clock, and then 3 o'clock I come up, and that's my office time until my daughter gets home from school at 4. And I, you know, do marketing and respond to emails, send out estimates, make orders, you know, all that fun administrative stuff happens in the afternoon. And then once my girls are home from school around 4 o'clock, I'm in mom mode until they're in bed. And then I'm usually putting another couple hours in once they're in bed, if I'm backed up or I've got lots of emails to answer, yeah, or whatever.
That sounds like a good way that you've broken up your day. Cause I know, like, I hear a lot of people, you get started in the morning with your emails and then you're on Facebook, and before you know it, it's like 10 o'clock and you haven't hit the workroom yet. So that's, yes, really good to do that at the end of the day. I like that.
Well, I had to, because I was getting sucked into that vortex and like, I didn't touch fabric at all today.
In that black hole. It's like, wow, it's lunchtime already. Where did the day, yes, go?
Yes, exactly. Mm-hmm.
So do you put in a typical 40-hour work week, or do you work more or less?
No, I definitely work more. Yeah. I probably put in 50 or 60 hours every week. My goal is to get more proficient and more organized so that I can get my weekends back as much as possible. During the week, I'm used to the craziness, but it would be nice to have, you know, at least one day on the weekend. But right now I'm still, let me go do this, let me go do that again. And it's right here. So it's easy to do that.
And I don't think people that are not self-employed understand that concept, because it's like, we don't get paid vacations. The work has to be done, and we're the only ones to do it typically. Mm-hmm. So it is that demand on your time all the time when you're self-employed.
Yeah. Yeah. And you're always thinking about it.
Yeah.
New ideas. And it's just, which in some ways is really exciting and motivating, and in other ways it can be a little exhausting sometimes too.
Yeah, I hear you.
please turn off.
Please just give me a little bit of a rest. So if you were going to start all over again from the very beginning, mm-hmm, is there anything that you would do differently than what you've done?
That's funny, because I think about that a lot, and having been in project management and in the corporate world, I'm like, I think I would have taken the time to put a whole business plan together and, you know, plan it all out better. But then the other part of me goes, maybe if you did that, you never would have done this. You know, you would have been too scared about all the risks and the potential issues and challenges you could face, and you never would have jumped in and done it. So while I think it would have been great to have had it all mapped out, I'm glad I'm doing it.
And the thing is too, I mean, I feel the same way you do. My husband and I often say, if we had known everything before we started, we would have never gotten going.
Right.
And the thing is, there's a lot of unknowns that even if you did plan it out, there's a lot of things about running these types of businesses that you don't even think of when, yeah, you're first starting out. So,
yeah. Yep. So, and thank goodness for you and others out there, because, you know, I had had experience and I had taken some classes, but every piece of upholstery is so different, and it can be different for multiple reasons. You know, the fabric, the chair, you know, you could do the same style chair with different fabrics and have to tackle some things differently. And, you know, without all the resources out there and people like you and your videos, it would have been even harder, I think. I don't know how people started these types of businesses when we didn't have the internet, yeah, and didn't have ways to connect with people, because we don't have centers where you can go and learn upholstery and get a certificate. You know, it's just, it's challenging. And so that makes it that much easier though, to have resources and to be like, okay, wait, let me see. I think Kim had a video out there, or I think, you know, I think I saw something on one of our forums about that. Let me go see it, because every project's so different, even if they look the same from the surface.
Exactly. That is such a good point, that, you know, like wingback chair, somebody will say to me, well, how much to get a wingback chair done, or how many hours is it going to take me to do this wingback chair? And they can be so different when you get into the bones of the piece of furniture.
Yeah. Yes, I always say we have to be, it's half science, half art, right? So part of us is like, there's an engineering piece and a science piece to it, but then there's the art of, yeah, but in this case, I think I'm going to do it a little differently.
And it's like a puzzle. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, your Humpty Dumpty to me was the perfect thing, because it is, everything comes apart and you've got to put that puzzle back together.
Yep. Yeah.
So do you have any words of wisdom to share with someone out there that either is getting started or thinking of going into this field?
You know, I'd say just don't let fear get in your way. Jump in, you know. You may look back 10 years on your first projects and go, I could have done those better. But you have to have the first projects. You have to have the first ones you do for clients somewhere. And just jump in and don't let fear get in the way. Because I think as a small business owner, especially when it's just you and you don't have anyone to kind of bounce some of those fears off of, we can be our own worst enemies sometimes and get in our heads and go, oh, I don't think that's going to be good enough. What if they don't like it? And I think when we're passionate about what we do and we try to keep learning every day and we put our heart and soul into it, we've got to just get out there and start doing it. That's how you get better.
Yeah. And we are our own worst critics. So I think you are right. And like, that's one thing I love about the community we've created is that everybody is so supportive and people will go and post on there. In fact, somebody just did yesterday and said, it's my first project. I know it's not perfect, but it looked good. And everybody supports
you. It looked
great.
I thought the same thing too. And yeah. I was like, good for her. That looks awesome.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And like you said, get started, just dive in. I love that.
Yeah.
So how can a prospective client find you, Rebecca?
Yeah, they can find me on the internet at RebeccaMunsterDesigns.com, as well as on Facebook at Rebecca Munster Designs. Those are probably the best ways to find me. They can also reach me by phone at 301-706-3367.
Great. So I invite all of you out there to go ahead and check out Rebecca's Facebook page as well as her website, because she's got some beautiful work out there to share with you. And if you're in her neck of the woods, give her a call and see if she can help you out with your projects. Thank you for doing this today. This was great, Rebecca.
Thank you.
Brought to you by Kim's Upholstery, where we bring the training to you.